Hello and welcome to a special Capital Edition. I'm John Goldsmith, and during the hour ahead, we're going to try to paint a portrait of the many faces of Alaska. The breathtaking picture postcard image that we have in the lower 48, and the real story of our 49th state, or at least as much of it as we can squeeze on a 21-inch canvas. Take it from someone who knows, this is a Texas-sized story times two.
It's so big. I'm really here writing about the Arctic because I think it's got to be an area of enormous interest in years ahead, inescapably so. But when you crank in Alaska too, then you've got a goodie.
We will crank in James Michener to help us read this novel state where the people take an almost perverse pride in being different.
It's insane, I guess, in the sense that that there are lots of attitudes. You know, a very popular Alaska bumper sticker says, "We don't give a damn how they do it outside." Outside is where you're from.
They're from Washington, D.C., from WUSA, and they're up here traveling around trying to do stories and find something that's sleazier than their own hometown.
Do we sense a slight undercurrent of anti-Washington sentiment here? Perhaps because neither bald eagles nor federal employees are an endangered species in Alaska, where the government rules the roost.
All Americans are saying, get governments off our back. Well, we're just trying to get them off our back. And we want them out of our yard, too.
Like Native Americans everywhere, the first Alaskans have become a tiny minority in their own land. But after 10,000 years, times are a-changin'. Take, for instance, one Indian village of 620 souls. To look at this place, would you imagine they casually assess their net worth at
60, 70, 80 million, depending on what you're appraising?
We'll be appraising the state of natives in Alaska. In some ways, they are staggering through the present, but they actually own the future. Ironically, here, it's the white man who has been kicked off the land.
So consequently, the people in Alaska are land poor. It's just hard to believe when you fly over and you see and look at all that, there's no people there. Because it belongs to the two government agencies, federal and state. And so what land is there that is available or could be available is native land.
You're better off fishing or sitting in jail than digging for gold on the Kayaka Trail.
We will sing the ballad of Stephen Brooks, a latter-day sourdough staking his claim on the last frontier.
A lot more freedom here, a lot more space, room to breathe, a slower pace. I used to be a nervous wreck by the time I got down to George Washington Parkway and went over the 14th Street Bridge to postal headquarters in those days. On the road for hours, here, five cars constitute a traffic jam.
And this constitutes a small cabbage.
The cabbage that ate Brooklyn. I mean, that's, what is that?
Oh, well, that's 50 pounds.
We will talk of cabbages and carving a farm out of the wilderness with a couple who settled here as colonists half a century ago. And we'll meet a lady lawyer turned homesteader who says she found the American dream here. We found a rather puzzling place of contrast and controversy. Except for its colorful past and stunning scenery, its character ill-defined, its personality multiple, its crisis one of identity, an enchanting state of mind rushing toward an uncertain future.
And so, for someone like me, Alaska is a tremendous invitation, as well as a challenge. different races, different people, different patterns of life.
What the Audubon Society says, this is the Alaska state bird. They have more of them than Washington has pigeons. Sleeping, swimming, or just sitting on a front lawn, they are everywhere. And more than anything else, the ubiquitous airplane seems to symbolize Alaska and its people. Their variety, their dependence on highways in the sky to get around, and the fact that they have experienced dramatic ups and downs, have displayed a penchant for taking off in many directions at once ever since we bought the place from a Russian czar. Sitka was the capital of Russian Alaska in 1867. What happened in that year would be remembered as the real estate deal of the century. Back then, however, many thought St. Petersburg got the best of the bargain, that Washington had agreed to pay too much for a detached and desolate part of the globe nicknamed Icebergia.
Interesting thing is, we paid $7,200,000 for it against an immense outcry in Congress. And in a few years later, 30 years later, in Nome, in 1 year, we took off the beaches of Nome more money than we paid for the whole of Alaska. Just one lucky shot. Let alone all the salmon and the timber and the gold elsewhere and the other minerals and the shipping, everything else. It's one of the best bargains we ever made.
Seward's Folly, they called it at the time, Seward's Icebox, for the Secretary of State who signed the purchase agreement at a middle-of-the-night meeting in Washington. Congress was reluctant to put money where Seward's pen was, so he asked a friend, local banker George Washington Riggs, to arrange a little loan, roughly 13 tons of gold, to buy Alaska.
I think that my coming to Alaska is a logical development. I started my career with the South Pacific. It treated me very well. I always had in the back of my mind that I ought to write about the North Pacific. Always felt I was too old to survive the hard Alaskan winters. That was when I was 48, I thought that. Now I'm going to be 80 shortly, and I figured if I'm going to do it, I might as well do it now.
And so, with his wife, his manual typewriter, and his old station wagon, James Michener moved to Sitka to write his next novel about the great land.
Now, I frequently think when I fly over Alaska, which I've done so much recently, on a sunny day and you see these great mountains, most of them aren't even named yet. They're just there. And you think, my goodness, you know, if that mountain were in Kansas, it would be famous all over the world.
For a couple of years now, he has lived as an Alaskan, exploring its past and present, and in his modest log cabin, contemplating the strategic role it will play in the future.
You hear a lot of wild comment about the closeness of communism in Nicaragua, which is, you know, a far distance off. Here, it's like this. Here, the United States is only a mile and a half from communist Russia. People forget that.
People forget not only where it is, but just how vast it is. To bring it home, in our neighborhood, Alaska would reach from Canada to the Bahamas, with the Aleutian Islands stretching west to the Great Salt Lake in Utah. How do you describe 375 million acres?
I think the best probably that I ever heard was John McPhee in his book, Coming Into the Country, said if, to give a sense of the size of Alaska, said if you could find a way to steal Italy, this would be the place to hide it.
Howard Weaver was born here. Not many adult Alaskans can make that claim. He's the managing editor of the state's largest newspaper. How would he describe the spirit of Alaska?
I wrote an essay once trying to explain statehood in, on our 25th anniversary. And I remembered the kind of pathetic excuse for a parade we used to have in Anchorage during our winter carnival. It'd be cold as hell, 10 degrees. I was in the high school band. We're marching along. The instruments froze up. You couldn't play. It's a small crowd, a small parade. But what I realized was, though, in Alaska, it's not the parade that matters. It's the parading. It's being a part of the parade, not standing around watching a float built by somebody else, but getting out there and marching, putting antifreeze on the trombone slides, finding a way to do it, to make it work. I think people want to do things, and that's the attraction. And you can here. You can.
But in the cavalcade of life here, everybody seems to be marching to the beat of a different drummer. At the extremes, there are those who want to exploit the state for everything it's worth. And there are those who want to protect every square inch of wilderness. In the middle, 500,000 opinions. They only seem to agree that they don't want anybody from the outside raining on their parade, even if they don't know where it's going. Senator Frank Murkowski.
That's one of the things that I get as a senator from concerned Alaskans. They say, look, we live here. Why do we have to have a dictate from Washington on federal policies, whether it be the Bureau of Land Management or the Forest Service or the Environmental Protection Agency? They say, we know Alaska. We live here. We understand it. We love it. We're going to take care of it.
Fur trapper turned congressman Don Young is even more adamant.
The preservationists that I call in this Washington, D.C. group, if they had their way, they'd put all Alaskans on an airplane, fly us out to someplace, and put us into little houses and leave it for their own little park. But that's not reality, nor is it proper for this United States. The need for resources is getting more each day, and yet we're locking up those lands that have the resources.
The preservationists would certainly quarrel with Young's characterization of them. But indisputably, very little of Alaska's real estate is being utilized by its people, almost half of whom live cheek to jowl in or around Anchorage, an urban area that seems out of place on the last frontier.
One taxi driver said the real great charm about Anchorage is that it's not only a fine modern city, but it's also only 12 miles from Alaska. And they call it Los Anchorage and a lot of other goodies.
But they can't call it the capital, at least not yet. That remains the relatively small and isolated city of Juneau. Accessible only by air and water, it could be nicknamed Washington North. For here, too, almost everybody is either catering to the needs of tourists.
Hi, Mom. Have a great time.
Or working for the government. Behind the facade of a charming gold rush community and an unassuming state capitol building lies a giant bureaucracy built with billions in oil revenues. That's right, these rugged individualists may be raining on their own parade, are probably the most governed people in America. Even before you add that there are more federal employees per capita managing Uncle Sam's interests here than anywhere outside of D.C.
And we have some parks, and Gates of the Arctic is one, where without question there are more people involved on the federal payroll in regulating the park and managing the park than there are visitors into the park. That's a fact. That is an absolute fact.
And the federal government is making it very, very tough. The federal government still owns two-thirds of it, and they don't do anything with what they own, and they get in the way so nobody can do anything with what's around them elsewhere.
Need we say, newspaper publisher Bob Atwood, an Alaskan since the 1930s, gets pretty worked up about the federal presence here in the 1980s.
They won't cooperate. We want to take care of the tourists. We want to, this is a grand country for tourists. It's good for people. It enriches your soul to get out and see this place. And Uncle Sam is always holding back, won't let us do it.
Can't start a fire. Can't start a fire in a national park. Can't start a fire. Even if you're freezing in the dark, can't start a fire. Can't start a fire in a national park. Can't start a fire.
Knocking federal regulations is a laughing matter at an Anchorage institution called Mr. White Key's Whale Fat Follies. Don't ask me what it means, folks. I'm still trying to figure out Alaska.
Eat fish from the river and polar bear liver and anything else you can dream. But the dream is believing when you see me beaming on the cover of a field and stream. Field and stream. I'll do my hunting from a Honda. I'm gonna bag my grizzly with a bazooka. I'm gonna hang some embers from my Cessna on the cover of a field and stream. On the cover of a field and stream. On the cover of a field and stream. On the cover.
Go much deeper than recorded history here. Stretch back long before the first Americans came and gave them names that were easy to pronounce. Before the Russian missionaries gave them their Orthodox religion. In fact, eons before any outsiders set foot on this soil, for hundreds of generations, the natives have been living off the land. Now, in the span of a single generation, living off the land has taken on a dramatic new meaning. Triggering the change, construction of the Trans-Alaska Oil Pipeline, which ran smack into the claim that in 1867, Russia sold the United States something it never owned, the ancestral lands of the natives. Paying the overdue bill with interest in 1971, Congress created a bunch of corporations the natives would operate and agreed to give them $1 billion and 44 million acres of real estate. Quite simply, says James Michener, it was the best deal any Native Americans have ever gotten.
I think we've made such a mess of land ownership among Indians in the lower 48. That oscillation between mainstreaming and reservation has been quite miserable. We've avoided that here. The United States can be very proud of Alaska today.
Be that as it may, and while some of their corporations are fabulously wealthy, Congress also created a whale of a monster, because most of the natives had never managed anything more complicated than a rudimentary village government.
And we're taken from that environment and placed into the very fast tracks of corporate world. We suddenly had millions of dollars to deal with, millions of dollars in assets to manage. And that was scary, and you know, there were mistakes made because of it.
Tlingit Indian Ivan Gamble is president of one of the 200 village corporations established by the Land Claims Act. His village is Angoon, on southeastern Alaska's Admiralty Island, a place that seems to have the patent on pristine wilderness and a never-ending supply of wildlife. that for centuries was all the Tlingits needed to survive. To survive today, they have had to develop ways counter to their historic lifestyle. Dick Powers, who came here as a Forest Service employee, now owns the only hunting and fishing lodge on the island.
I think you're correct. I think the Tlingit culture runs very contrary to the capitalistic approach. The most important Tlingit in the world is the one that gives the most away.
A most admirable trade, except that the Tlingits, like natives throughout the state, have become the salmon in the mainstream of Alaskan life. And if they grow weak, they risk being devoured by those who know their land holdings represent virtually all future development here. Congressman Young.
The only private land in the state of Alaska are the native lands. Private. The rest are federally owned and state owned. The state is not letting its lands go. So what we have is a great desire by that 500,000 people for land to achieve it. You can't even buy it because it belongs to the two government agencies, federal and state. And so what land is there that is available or could be available is native land.
And the pressure is building. In the 1990s, the Aleuts, the Indians, the Eskimos will have the option of selling out, cashing in the stock they hold in those native corporations, losing perhaps not only their ancestral lands, but their bond with the past.
Yes. They are under very heavy pressure. Yes, if allowed to drift, they are going to be submerged by contemporary society. It's overwhelming. The lure of the automobile, the lure of television, the lure of store-bought clothes, the lure of food in cans is overwhelming. It is for you, it is for me. Why shouldn't it be for some Eskimos?
At Sea Alaska, one of 13 regional corporations also created by Congress, a heritage foundation is trying to guard against the temptation to take the money and leave the culture behind. David Katsik is foundation president.
To me, it's a tragedy if that's done. In a way, you're leaving family history behind. Maybe some of the history that we might leave behind we don't really want to have anyway, but still I think there's some real values in the history and the culture and the tradition.
That logic has won the day in Angoon, where the natives have voted against the short-term economic gain of logging their land in order to preserve their traditional subsistence lifestyle. In fact, the Angoon elders have even gone to Washington, lobbying Congress to prevent logging operations in the only unprotected section of their island.
Holding on to our subsistence lifestyle, our culture, is probably going to be the most important decisions we've made so far. It reminds us of who we are and where we've been and where we're going.
But Gamble's village of 620, with an estimated worth of $80 million, has an estimated unemployment rate of 80%. Given that equation, there are those who want to grab their slice of the American pie. Angoon elder Cyril George.
They want their share of the land. And as I speak to some of them, do you intend to ever come back to Angoon? No. Well, what about your children? No. So when we talk about these things, we get the feeling that all they want that land for is to sell so they can have bucks in their pocket.
Native Alaskans remain strongly under the influence of an earlier legacy from Western civilization. Sudden wealth may prove even more intoxicating. How they handle it will not only decide their future, but in large measure, the future of the last frontier.
And so a great deal is up for grabs in Alaska right now. This isn't at all like Iowa. This isn't at all like Nevada. Tremendous decisions are about to be made here. Controlling 44 million acres of the best part of Alaska, all up for grabs.
Alaska is not the birthright of most of its citizens who have climbed on board in the quarter century since statehood. Jan Thompson will have their story when Capital Edition continues its journey on the last frontier.
Search of wealth, adventure, and freedom. The definitions of those words have changed dramatically over the decades, and so has Alaska. But the lure remains much the same for the latter-day settlers. There is still the perception of greater independence here, and although much of the gold is gone, the golden opportunities endure. Just ask Pat Doherty, who came here from Washington as a young reporter, and is now the young city editor of the biggest newspaper in the state. There's an even more stunning success story for his ex-wife,
who came up here also as a journalist, ended up being in charge of oil and gas leasing for the state of Alaska, managing the Prudhoe Bay oil field for the state of Alaska at like age 32.
Or just drop by the Shiloh Baptist Church in Anchorage and ask Reverend Alonzo Patterson, who came up here with the Army 23 years ago and never left.
Alaska just has a tremendous opportunity, business, employment. In spite of our deprivation of employment and economics now, we have one of the more promising potentials here in the last frontier than any other place I've ever been.
Or just ask our taxi driver, Bob Engelbrecht, who arrived as a pilot and now manages a large helicopter service.
Up and flying for one summer and fell in love with it and decided to stay. Been up here for about 8 years now. It has lived up to all my expectations. There was a lot of opportunity up here. It's been a good place for me, a good move.
Some who live here are just along for the ride, and that too is the way it's always been. Many of the gold miners, the pipeline workers, the men who built this very railroad shared the sentiment of conductor Dean Reedy, who told John that after 12 years, he still doesn't think of Alaska as home.
Well, because I don't particularly care for 8 months of winter. You know, I like the sun and the heat. I'm here strictly for one reason.
High pay.
Right.
Welcome back to KNBC's Breakfast Club. This is Steve Brex, and we're coming to you from the Windbreak Cafe in Wasilla, Alaska. We have to let you know that in case you're listening overseas.
The voice on the radio belongs to transplanted Washingtonian Steve Brooks, who has put down roots in the town of Wasilla. He and his community seem to symbolize the new Alaska, somewhere between its laid-back, unregulated past and its future potential for growth and development.
You can make it happen here, and it doesn't have the restrictions at this point that you find in Fairfax County, Virginia, where if you try to build any business, you have to go through so many layers of bureaucracy that you're probably burned out if you don't have the cash reserve and the fortitude to go on with it. So what you're dealing with here is, if you have a dream, I wanted a radio station, and I found a place to put it, and I found a bunch of working stiffs like myself, and we pooled our money and 100 bucks at a time, and we just built a radio station, and we put it on the air. We're coming to you live from the Windbreak Cafe. We have Senator Frank Murkowski with us, and Mrs. Murkowski, Nancy Murkowski.
The station is a sideline. Brooks still works for the Interior Department in Anchorage. At his request, he was transferred to Alaska 6 years ago, and at first, he hated it.
We live in Anchorage, number one, and I told you before, Anchorage reminds me of Fort Lee, New Jersey, perhaps not as pretty It's a squat town. I'm going to have the Anchorage Convention and Visitors Bureau on me. It is not a pretty town.
So he moved to outlying Wasilla, in a sparsely populated county the size of all of New England, and a world away from his old hometown of Reston, Virginia. In that planned community, he recalls, he couldn't even paint the front door of his townhouse without permission. In this unplanned community, where the Alaskan legacy of independence still prevails, he owns two horses, a noisy dog, built a stable onto his home,
come on, Sonny. Come on, boy.
Along with a tack shop operated by his wife, and nobody cares, because there's no zoning here. There's very little regulation, period.
We did have a police department for 60 days at one time. I was one of the first police commissioners of the city of Wasilla. And we hired a police chief, and we got ready to set up the police department, and 200 or 300 people got together and caused a referendum to be held, and they canceled the police department in Wasilla. One of the few places in the whole United States where a police department was canceled.
Despite the fact that the gray days often ruin his view of the mountains, and the future of the state is equally cloudy, Brooklyn-born Steve Brooks says this is where he was meant to be.
I think I was always an Alaskan, and they just needed to come here to find out about it. They had to manifest itself. I like the freedom. Here I have the beauty, the wide open spaces, and the opportunity to do anything I want.
Beauty, come on. Once I'd seen it, and the beauty of it, the friendliness of the people, and the thought of having my own homestead with my own lake, it just, I said, well, this is home. This is, for the first time, possibly a part of my part of the American dream.
It was 28 years ago when lawyer Mahala Ashley Dickerson came here on a vacation from Indianapolis. She went home, packed up her three small children, and returned to become a homesteader on 160 acres of the last frontier.
The excitement of it, you know, the challenge of it, was what drew me. And I felt like the ones down below were the ones missing out, not those of us up here.
Yeah, I used to come out here and dictate, you know, and just sit, just enjoy.
Did you find that it was difficult being a single woman living out here on 160 acres by yourself? I mean, weren't you afraid of the wildlife?
No, I wasn't afraid. But see, I had such wonderful neighbors. I was the only one who was single and the only one who was black. But when you're cold and when you're stuck in the mud and when you need help, nobody thinks anything about color. You know, they know that it can be you today, it might be me tomorrow. And I think that that's one reason all of us who homesteaded in those early days got to be so close to each other. As we look back on it now, we say, now look, how would it be crazy to do that? But we'd always do it again if we could do it with the same people.
A lot of people come here because they hear that it's the land of opportunity. Do you believe that's still the case?
I think it is. I think it's still the land of opportunity, but it's for people who have a lot of energy and who really don't mind working. It's not the place for a person who doesn't want to work. And there's something about it that makes you want to work, you know? Now, when I first came here, I was 45 years old, and every time I would pick up the newspaper in Indianapolis, on the front page would be a lawyer. Lawyer succumbs at 45 with heart attack. 45 just seemed to be the age of the heart attack. I said, well, that just shouldn't be. I said, but I'm going, when I get to Alaska, I will take it easy. You know, I'll try maybe two or three cases a year, and I'll do some writing. None of that happened. I was busier than ever and felt like working, you know? It's a funny thing. There's something in this place that gives you a renewed energy. You just feel like doing things. I don't know what it is, but I'm glad it's here. Of course, I can never leave Alaska. It's home.
People since territorial days would come up here to get what they could get and leave. And what this state needs more than anything else in the world is people that consider this home and put their roots down here.
Half a century ago, when America was in the grips of the Great Depression, somebody in Washington had what he thought was a great idea. Take some farmers from the Midwest who have fallen on hard times and send them north to Alaska. They would become latter-day colonists, homesteaders. They would get a new life out of the deal, a new start. And hopefully they would develop an agricultural industry in this wilderness territory. Like a lot of ideas hatched in Washington, it didn't quite work out that way. But if you ask Ray and L.V. Rabarchak, it worked out just fine. Today, an old hatchet is one of their links with the past. It came with them from Minnesota back in the spring of 35, when the colonists arrived in this valley on the edge of civilization, moved into a makeshift tent city until they could transform forests into farms. During the first few difficult years, more than half of them would call it quits. But not Ray and L.V., who took to the land right from the start.
Oh, I guess I'm an easy adjuster. When we drew our land place, there was just a little bit of not really clear land, but, you know, the road had been built in there and so on. And there were currant bushes, lots of currant bushes out there. And I said, well, this is home. You know, when there's currants and raspberries growing, what more do you want? It's a land that will produce.
Now, when you got to this piece of property, to the 40 acres that you were buying for $2.50 an acre, what was here?
Nothing. Nothing was here. It was absolutely timber right to the line. There was a survey line here and down. It wasn't completely surveyed at that time. The surveying crew were working. And they asked me to work in the surveying crew, and I refused. I didn't want to. So then they asked me to work uptown, unloading windows and doors and stuff. So I worked there half a day, and I said, hey, this ain't what I come here for. And I come right back here and start cutting logs.
Some of those logs became the Rabarchak farmhouse, the very first home built by the colonists and their government providers. In later years, Ray would cover over the mistakes with gray stucco. He says they made a lot of mistakes building this old house.
Every corner was different. And anyway, we ended up getting this house, and I was unhappy all the way. And I said, well, that's okay. I'll use this for a chicken house. After a while, I'll build one that I want. But this never happened. It got slowed down with work. So we got along the best we could.
In those early days, Ray and L.V. were not in the picture together. Although they came up on the same boat with some 200 families, Ray had a different wife, who never really took to the farm and eventually left. L.V. was married and cultivating her own experiences, but then her husband died. Ultimately, their mutual love of this land brought them together. Now, they are among the few survivors of a grand experiment under which the government provided everything but gave nothing away, loaned them the money to buy a new life.
It was Roosevelt's pet project when he wanted to do something, you know, to develop Alaska. And that's the main reason we came here. And of course, there was quite a difference in what agreement we signed, and when we got here, everything cost us 3 and 4 times as much, so we had a huge debt, you know, by the time we were here a year. A lot of them quit on account of that, because they said, hell, you'll never pay that off.
And it was true. They never could. In fact, the government had to reduce the debt because farming would only survive here, never thrive. The idea may have died, but the legend has not. The early lives and times of those colonial families are the sort of stuff Alaskan stories are made of. Take the one about that special workhorse, more of a pet, really, that ate everything from fish to hotcakes and would come calling, looking for handouts, sometimes in the middle of the night.
She had come to the door and rattled the doorknob several times. She wanted something to eat when she smelled it, you know. She was running loose. We didn't even have to have her on her fence. And I heard the door rattling, and I said, well, that damn horse is down there again, waking us up. And I went over there and opened the door, and there was a bear standing there looking in the window like that. Well, my hair stood up, and I shut the door pretty quick-like.
In the fertile Matanuska Valley, Washington's great experiment failed because reliable food supply lines from the lower 48 were well established, not because of Alaska's notorious weather, which, in this area at least, is not as severe as the Rabarcheks had experienced back in Minnesota.
It's a lot milder here. We don't have it as cold as they do there in the winter. And we don't have it as hot in the summer. They can raise things like corn and beans and pumpkins and melons where we can't.
Only cold weather produce do well, say potatoes and rutabagas, turnips and cabbage and kohlrabi. That sort of thing will grow well. If we didn't get oranges, well, so what? We had cabbage.
We make sauerkraut.
Yes, indeed, they have cabbage, growing 60, 70, even 80 pounds, thanks to hybrid seeds, the long summer days, and tender, loving care. They'll actually burst at the seams if touched before their time.
Now you get over there and help me hold it. And face it.
Every year, the farmers compete with their colossal cabbages for top honors at the state fair, which, as Ray recalls, began modestly enough half a century ago.
There were pigs there and calves, and I think there was a cow or two. But all the vegetables were there, and canned goods, canned fish, and smoked fish, but there was no, like they have now, machinery and hot dog stands or nothing. There was none of that the first couple of years. And that was right in town, right there where the Pioneer Home is now. That was the fairground. And then, of course, they started getting bigger and bigger, and pretty soon they had to have more land, and they come and bought land out here.
And now the fair is Ray's neighbor and has grown into such a gigantic event that during its 11-day run, it attracts a number of visitors equivalent to a third of the entire population of the state. The fact that the fair and real estate developers would like to take over the Rabarchek farm says something about growth and development in South Central Alaska. Something an old farmer doesn't like to see.
Because I didn't want to see too many people. And according to my way of thinking, there's too many people here now. I liked it the way it was.
I guess he did. Ray voted against joining the union. And in a throwback to territorial days, he still refers to the rest of the country as the states. Ray Rabarchek has two dreams left, that the government will take over his old farm and preserve it, so future generations will know what the colonists did here, and that he and his old tractor wear out at about the same time.
Heartbreakingly beautiful to me. Alaskans still take a second seat to Alaska, I think. It's those mountains and those coastlines and the rivers and oceans, and that's what Alaska is to me.
This is a land of opportunity, it really is. And how long it's going to last, I don't know. But you can, if you're willing to work hard and be dedicated, you can make it here.
I'm always for new people coming, if they want to come and stay and contribute, but not just take what we have and go.
The glories of the country, going out and fishing and hunting and enjoying these resources, it's terrific and it's overwhelming. You never get over it.
States can be very proud of Alaska today.